Good afternoon. I'm Walt Bauer, and I'd like to welcome you to the Human Development Institute's first fall seminar. We welcome the participants who are joining us online through Zoom, as well as the participants who are here with us at the live presentation at the Human Development Institute at the University of Kentucky. Our presenters will provide an opportunity for questions this afternoon, and we welcome questions from all our participants. If you have questions online, please type your questions into the chat box. Should you have any questions about CEUs, you can contact me. Please take a moment at the conclusion of our seminar to complete a brief evaluation. The evaluation will be sent to your email address immediately after the seminar concludes. It is really helpful as we plan for upcoming seminars. Now, to introduce today's speakers, Brooke Gill is the social and emotional consultant for the Department of Public Health, Division of Maternal and Child Health. Brooke is a certified Kentucky early childhood trainer. Caroline Gooden is associate director of early childhood for the Human Development Institute at the University of Kentucky. Caroline is also a certified Kentucky early childhood trainer. The title of the seminar is Connect the Dots, Addressing Challenging Behaviors While Promoting Social and Emotional Development. I'm now going to turn it over to Brooke and Caroline.
Yay! Hi! Thank you. We have a lot of people joining us today, and we're really excited about that. Raise your hand if you're here because you have perfect angels at home and perfect angels in your classrooms, and you're just here to learn about all the reasons that you have such calm students. Is that anybody? No. Raise your hand if you're here because challenging behaviors is something you struggle with on a daily basis. Something that has you a little bit frazzled and confused. Yeah. And you're here because you want to learn some strategies that can not only minimize those challenging behaviors, but really are in the best interest of the kids in your classroom and in your home. Today, we're going to talk about how we can decrease challenging behaviors while promoting social and emotional development. Social emotional development are things like why we have sound decision-making skills, what provides us the ability to empathize with our friends when they're in pain and share in their joys when they get really great news. It's our ability to have a moral compass about the way we conduct our lives and to say, that doesn't seem so good. And, oh yeah, I think this is the right thing to do. Our morality. It's our ability to take a self-inventory and say, I'm getting really fired up right now. I probably need to walk away. That's our self-understanding. And although those sound like traits of some adults that we know, they're actually developing those characteristics when we were 2, 3, 4, and 5 years old at alarming rates. So we see the most challenging behaviors in kids 2 to 5 because it's like a blank slate of all of those social and emotional skills. But yet they are thrown into an environment with people that want to have their toys, an adult they have to share with 15 other kids, and all kinds of confusing questions going through their minds. Today we're going to talk about 4 strategies. And these 4 strategies are ensuring a supportive environment, encouraging positive behaviors, emphasize positive discipline, and embracing unique strengths. These 4 strategies are what we call universal strategies. Universal simply means it applies to all children. Every child in your classroom, every child in your home, these 4 strategies apply. However, there are some kids in your class that are going to require some more intensive social-emotional supports. And I was speaking with a few of you before the training, and there are those kiddos in your classrooms that need individualized behavior support plans. We're not going to get into those today. This is just a 2-hour social-emotional overview. But I will tell you, just like the pyramid indicates, this is a great foundation for even those kids. So we can use these strategies with all children, but it's important to understand that there will be a few children in your care that are going to need a little bit more. So when you guys leave here today, we're going to have a firm understanding of these 4 strategies and what they mean. And you're also going to leave with some concrete tools. Don't we all like to walk out of a training and say, oh, I know exactly what I'm going to do on Monday. So we're going to give you that exactly what to do on Monday. And I challenge you to at least take 2 away. You'll probably be introduced to 20-ish, maybe more. But try to hold on to 2 and really concentrate on making those 2 apply to your classroom or the families you work with on Monday. The number one thing we want you guys to take with you is we're not going to have any more bad responses. I want everybody to just say, no more bad responses.
No more bad responses.
All right, thanks. Didn't feel that much energy from that, but I'll take it. So no more bad responses. What is a bad response? So everybody hold in your mind that one behavior that absolutely makes you want to climb the wall. And you know it's coming usually. The thing about bad or challenging behaviors is that we know when they're coming and we dread them like the plague. So you're sitting in your classroom and everything's kind of going good and you know you're about to announce time for lunch and you know it's going to be like you threw a bomb in the room and you dread all the challenging behaviors that might come out of that. So the first thing we usually feel is, can anybody relate to that? That feeling of, oh, not today. I just don't have time for it today. Usually because we're feeling like that, we kind of go into step two rather quickly because kids feed off of our tones, right? So they're a little upset, we join in feeling upset, and then we kind of go to this moment of agitation. Because these emotions are so strong and because we're usually not one-on-one with kids, we have a lot of things going on. We go to a third step, which is the D, default to pleading. And this is where we usually give in to the negative behavior because we want it to stop. Or we get into this like negotiation with a three-year-old, like don't negotiate with Harris. Like we're, okay, if I give you 6 pieces of candy, you promise you won't throw a fit in Kroger. And they're like, 7. And you're like, fine, 7, right? So you get into this thing and what are you doing? You're actually feeding into that negative behavior. You're saying what you're doing is working and I'm gonna feed into it. They're gonna keep upping the ante to see how high you're gonna climb. So we call that D, default to pleading. So what are we gonna do? No more what? Bad responses. Instead of feeling bewildered, we're hoping that you're gonna leave here today and feel prepared with options ready to go. Does that feel nice? To say, you know what? Bring on your next tantrum. I want to connect the dots. I'm ready for you. Which means you're not gonna have this sense of agitation. So you're not gonna go from "Bah," to "Oh, I'm gonna wring your neck." Instead, you're gonna feel empathetic, calm, and decisive. We're gonna learn why kids are having these challenging behaviors. And when they start to sound off, instead of seeing them as this little pestering person, we're actually gonna picture them with this little help sign behind them. Because what we're gonna learn is challenging behaviors is a child telling you, I don't have the tools to solve this problem. And I'm hoping you're gonna help me. So when we come into it and we add chaos to a situation that already has plenty of it, we're ignoring this big, huge help sign behind them. So instead of agitated, we're gonna be empathetic and calm and help them make a decision. Which means we're gonna no longer give in to these negative behaviors and instead we're gonna have meaningful, teachable moments. Who's excited about that? Everybody in here is excited. All right. So on your sheet, if you're a handouter here, it's prepared, empathetic, and calm. And what we're not gonna do is look at this two-year-old who obviously is desperate for help, right? I mean, he's waving his help sign. And we're not gonna turn this into a self-assured, confident, independent kindergartner overnight. It's gonna take time. We're gonna have to be consistent. Behaviors are something you teach just like every other skill. You don't teach a kid how to read in a weekend. You're not gonna teach a kid how to ride a bicycle in the afternoon. And you're not gonna teach a kid how to go from screaming, kicking, crying, totally lost to, excuse me, mother, I need some help, please. Like, it's not going to happen. It's gonna take a while. And it's gonna take consistent responses from us as the adult in the situation to help them go from this to that. So you're not gonna have bad responses, not because I'm about to hand you a magic wand that's gonna fix it over the weekend, but because you're gonna learn how to connect the dots and you're gonna feel like the one in control rather than the one being manipulated. Everything we go over today, including what I just went over, all the handouts that Walt sent to you guys, everything is on our website. We also have 100 Connect the Dots trainers across the state. Usually this is an all-day training. And then we condensed it to 3 hours, and then we found out we had to condense it to 2 hours and then shave off another 15 minutes for question and answer. So this is quite condensed. So if you're hearing something, man, that sounds interesting, or I'd love to see some more tools on that, everything is on the website. Everything's free, downloads, templates, cool classroom tools, lots of materials you can use one-on-one with parents. So we encourage you to go to that website, My email's there too if you want to book a training. So I just don't want you to feverishly take notes or feel like you can't keep up. Just enjoy the training today and know that everything is there, including our contact information. So in order to address challenging behaviors in a way that promotes social-emotional development, we have to understand a little bit about what's happening in this kiddo's brain when they're having a meltdown in Kroger. And what's happening is you want to kind of picture this blank slate. So at birth, we don't have a whole lot going on. And we used to think that our brain at birth had everything in there, and it was just a matter of kind of turning everything on. Now we know that we are building this brain till 6 years old. At 6 years old, it starts to prune away into what we use as adults. So if you think about it, our smartest years were actually back in first grade, technically. So we have to lay a really good foundation because that's what they're going to carry with them into teenage and to adulthood. So when we say it's literally the foundation for life and school success, that's exactly what it is. So the way to think about all of these squiggly lines, which isn't too pretty of a picture, is a roadmap. So if I told you you had to drive 2.5 hours today to your best friend just moves away 2.5 hours, and you're going there for the first time, what are you going to do? Plug it into your phone, right? Probably not going to map out. So we're going to go with our phones. So you're going to have your phone and you're going to drive and you're going to follow that GPS the entire way, right? Probably even going to take a wrong turn because it's the first time you've gone there and it's kind of a funky way. The second day you go, you're still going to hold on to your GPS and follow it from point A to point B, but you're probably not going to make that wrong turn. The third day, you're going to plug it into the GPS, but you might have it in the passenger seat and be like, yeah, I think I got it. Fourth, fifth, sixth day you drive it. I guess you visit your best friend a lot, by the way. Every day, 2.5 hours. So on the sixth day you drive it, you're glad the GPS is in the car, but you aren't going to need it for every turn that you make. If you drive that path for 2 months in a row, you could take probably a year off from driving it. Get on the road, get a little bit on the way, and remember exactly how you got there, right? That path has literally been cemented into your mind. There's a neural connection in your brain that tells you how to get from point A to point B, and you remember it after you've driven it enough times with some guidance. We have to see challenging behaviors the exact same way. So whenever a kid feels frustrated, call frustrated point A. Somebody, I'm a 2-year-old and I just got to this class and I'm playing with my blocks and somebody just smacked them all over. I'm sorry, what just happened? Because this does not happen at home. They're feeling this angst and this anxiety and this frustration and these huge feelings they have never felt before. And there is no map in their brain on how to get from that feeling to calm. So sometimes what we do is we come in and we say, we try to start problem solving for them and rushing it. And it's like somebody coming up to you and telling you all the directions on how to get from point A to point B, but you need to drive it yourself 3 or 4 times before you feel confident about doing it by yourself. We need to see ourselves as the GPS for these kids. When a challenging behavior strikes, they're telling you, I don't know the roadmap here. I'm gonna need some guidance. You're gonna have to show me how to get from here to here, not once, not twice, but several times. And then you can back off a little bit and I can try it on my own. And if I do it on my own enough, I'm probably gonna still be glad you're in the car with me, but I think I got it from here. And we have to realize that each big emotion is a brand new roadmap for them. So we might get frustration, we knock that out. Maybe it's a kid who's got lots of siblings at home. They probably got several roadmaps for frustration. But they may not have a roadmap for something else. And they come in and mom's never left them before. So that transition on that first day is huge for them because there is nothing in their mind telling them how to go from scared and lonely without mom to feeling okay about it and comfortable in this new environment. Does that make sense? Okay. So where's their GPS? So what I wanted to challenge us to do is when we see this kid freaking out, we think to ourselves, something needs connecting. They don't know how to get from here to here. The way these connections are built is between upstairs is connecting to downstairs. And you do this in 3 levels. We do it still as adults. We go from survival, am I safe? Constantly we're scanning for safety. The second is, okay, I'm safe, how do I feel? If those feelings aren't too intense, then something else gets turned on, which is our thinking cap. And it says, okay, what do I do? What are my options? How do I problem solve in this situation? If at any point in this process, something goes off, an alarm, picture this, the brain can't go to the next level. So let's say we're driving on our merry way from point A to point B, and the person in front of you slams on their brakes. What do? You slam on your brakes, right? You don't even think about it. Does anybody go like this, even if there's nobody in the passenger seat? Because you're not thinking. You are simply reacting to that situation. There's no problem-solving pattern, and that's good because there are some situations where we need to just react. We don't need to say, should I slam on my brakes? Or by then you've already crashed. So it's important that our brain does kind of hijack certain situations. But we also have to understand that kids get hijacked in situations that we don't see as survival. So when we think, why did you just hit him in the face? It's actually them thinking, I've got to protect myself right now. So we call that flipping our lid. I don't know why that's up there. So the first thing they have to think is, am I safe? Fight, flight, or freeze. If it passes that sniff test, if you will, then they go on to, how does that make me feel? And they do a little evaluation of the emotions that are associated with that situation. Once it passes the feelings test, then they can go into problem solving. So when we talk about flipping our lid, this is a way to kind of remember it. If you put your hand up, this is your brain. At the bottom here is your survival. If it says, yep, everything's safe here, good to go, then your next part of your brain is your emotions or your limbic system. And then your thinking cap can go on. If at any point your body senses things are not safe or there is too intense of an emotion here, we flip our lid. So if you see a kid smack over those blocks and the kid reacts and smacks the other one in the face and you walk over and say, why did you do that? They have no idea why they did that because they're here. So what we have to understand when we go into a challenging behavior is we first have to figure out, where are they? Are they thinking with this downstairs brain right now? Or are we in some upstairs thinking? Sometimes it might be upstairs thinking. They might be manipulating the situation a little bit, but not always. Sometimes they're reacting from a pure emotional standpoint and they just fought back. So knowing this, we have a job. I want us to all say this together. My job is to recognize difficult behavior as a child telling me he or she needs social and emotional skills to solve problems. It's about coaching, not controlling, right? So the first thing we want to do is you're safe. And that might be getting on their level. Sometimes it's just showing them, I'm in this with you. Your popsicle fell on the floor, and right now, that is crisis mode. So we can just get on the, oh, your popsicle fell on the floor. Oh. And that shows them, like, somebody's in this with me, and they get it. Like, this is, what are we going to do about this? And you're like, the second thing you're doing is you're showing them, I'm here for you. I'm here with your emotions. Or even name them. Caroline's going to talk about a name it to tame it. Help them understand what's happening. You must be really disappointed. You're validating that for them, right? So you're getting on their level. You're validating it. Now you probably have somebody listening. You've probably got that lid unflipped, right? Then you can come in and say, now there aren't any more popsicles, but here's what I do have. Now we've got somebody that's got their thinking cap on. If we come in and say, oh, there's plenty of popsicles. You had a popsicle yesterday. All we're doing is keeping the kid here. And we don't have anything to work with. We don't have a conversation yet. Once we've coached them through the choices, then we recognize that they went through the process. You handled that really well. I know you were super disappointed that popsicle fell on the floor, but man, you got right back up. You chose a new snack. I'm proud of you. That's really cool. Then they're like, yeah, I got this. So the next time the popsicle falls on the ground, that's why it's a circle. This alarm may not go off as much as it did the first time, and especially is not as loud as it's going to go off if they remember how much they didn't get any help, right? So if they drop that popsicle and then that situation continued to escalate, then this alarm is just going to get louder the next time the situation repeats itself. And that's really what we're talking about. It's the whole brain. It's the whole development interaction within a challenging behavior. We also have to do it for ourselves. We have to tell ourselves, all right, this is not an emergency. The popsicle fell on the floor. This child is in my room for a reason. I got this. I have choices, tools, and resources. And then we have to reflect on our own strengths. So I'm hoping everybody did the strength survey as their pre-homework. And we'll go over that a little bit at the end. And that's what allows us to get in that calm mode. So Caroline's going to demonstrate real quick what these four dots look like in action. So I'm going to ensure she feels safe, which is something you're going to do probably before the behavior strikes. I'm going to make sure our connection is good and she's got a full bucket. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. And then if it's still needed, I'm going to tell her some positive choices that she has. And then I'm going to praise her for going through this process with me. So I'm just going to walk through all four and see if on your own you can kind of pick up as I move from each step. The situation is Caroline's playing blocks. It's getting ready to be lunchtime. And she has a fit every day. I say, time for lunch. It's always a meltdown, so I dread it. But not anymore, because I took connect the dots, right? No more bad responses. All right. In 5 minutes, we're going to clean up. And then it's going to be lunchtime. You're doing a great job with those. I like that. Did you put the orange one on top? Oh, that's a cool idea. I like what you're doing. All right, 5 more minutes, and then we're going to go to lunch. 2 more minutes, and we're going to clean up and go to lunch. Hey, I like that you're working on your tray. We're going to put all the blocks on the tray, and then your choice is either to set them over there on the table, or you can leave them right there, and we'll pick them up after lunch. Tell me what you're building. Tell me about it.
It's a robot.
It's a robot! You are so creative to make a robot out of blocks. I love that. Now what are you going to put on there?
I don't know yet.
Okay. All right. All right. 1 more minute, everybody. Okay, let's line up. Everybody put your stuff away. Time to line up and go to lunch. Caroline, remember we have 2 choices. We can leave it here or you can set it over there. Your choice. Your choice. You're going to leave it right there? All right, come on. I love that you made that decision all by yourself. You're like a 5-year-old, not a 3-year-old. I swear. Okay, so that would be connect the dots in the full, in all four, in sequence. Now Caroline's going to go into each individual dot, and we're going to talk about some concrete tools. Does anybody have any questions about why these are the 4 strategies or anything that we've talked about so far? No? All right. Any questions online, Walt?
Not yet.
Okay.
Yeah, we encourage you, if you're online, you have questions, just chat, put them in the chat, and Walt will be your voice. So we'll have voice from across the state. So what we're going to look at now is each component of the Connect the Dots. And you have in front of you or on your computer, you have a copy of the poster. And you can follow along as we do the next 4 sections if you wish. If you look on the back of your poster, it tells you about each one of these dots and some of the components that we're going to talk about today. So looking at the first one, we're talking about how to ensure supportive environments for our children. In other words, we want to look and make sure that the environments that we have, whether at school or at home or wherever, playground, that it's designed for the children and really not for us, but for them. So we're going to look at their behaviors and see if they're telling us if they're comfortable in their surrounding or if they perhaps need extra help, need extra time, need my help to make a transition more smooth. So I'm really going to watch their behavior and see if they're getting the cues that they need from the environment. Some of the tools in our toolbox that we're going to talk about today, I'm sure that you all use lots of these. This may be review for some of you. It may be new for some of us. And we're going to share together how these tools work for us. Some of the things that we're going to look at in ensuring supportive environments is some of the schedules and routines we have, some of the tools we have for starting and stopping activities, setting limits, engaging activities and surroundings that are there for our children's needs, and having age-appropriate expectations. And really, at this point, I want to look and see if the children are telling me, yes, this environment works for me. It's my size. It meets my needs. that's what their behavior is telling me or not. So we're going to look at some tools that will help us do this. The first thing that we're going to look at is it's important to have as many visual cues as we can. We know that our kids learn lots of different ways. They learn visually, they learn auditorily, they learn by doing. So this is an example of some visual aids. We want to have schedules as much as possible that show children what's coming up and what's happening in their day. So we can either have a schedule where we have the children's real pictures, which is a great way for them to identify, simple pictures of them with simple word activities, or we can have a schedule like this that Brooke is showing us that has more generic pictures and directions. And how we can use these, as you know, is when the children come in for the first part of the day, they see their whole day in front of them with what's coming up. They know what's happening. And as an activity is completed and closed, we can close the door and they know that that is no longer an option. And it's time to get ready for the next activity. So it's a really helpful way for them to see visually what's coming and to know what we expect. So any kind of visual schedule there, or this kind of visual schedule as well. Another important tool that we can use for ensuring supportive environments is to limit surprises. Some flexibility is a great thing. We also don't want to spring a lot of surprises on children because that will throw them. It throws us as well. And we want to explain when changes are coming. So one example is if I get to work in the morning and I know it's going to be a rainy day and I know we're not going to get to go outside, that is an option that's coming off my calendar for the day. So instead of having a sunny day, I'm going to have raindrops on my calendar for the time that we usually play with gross motor time. So they know when they come to school that, you know, instead of going outside today, we're going to play in the gym because it's a rainy day. And if the weather changes during the day, we can change our schedule as well, make it flexible so that we can let them know it's either a sunny day or a rainy day activity. Another thing that we can do is we can explain when changes are happening. There can be some exciting new things that happen during the day. It's not so exciting for children if suddenly their routine changes and they have no advance warning. So if one of the dads comes in the morning and says to me, you know, I'd love to come back at lunchtime and read them a story while they're eating, that's a wonderful thing. I also want to build it into my routine so that they know ahead of time that it's coming. So I might put on my schedule at lunchtime, I might put a picture of that dad by the lunch schedule and begin to tell the kids in advance, we've got a dad who's coming today at lunch and he's going to read to us, so that when that time comes, they're ready and they're prepared and Johnny doesn't freak out because his dad walks in and he's not sure why. So it's important to limit those surprises and take time to explain changes when they're before they're going to happen. Any other examples that you all think of along these lines that you've done? Dave might have one. Here's another thing that we know with children and routines is that transitions are a really challenging time, social emotional skill development that doesn't happen naturally. So when children first come to school, they're being expected to follow a lot of different routines and change from activity to activity. And that's something that they need our help learning to do. There's several components to transitions that we're going to talk about in practice today. And Brooke is going to be our student now. She's going to play with some blocks and we'll talk through some examples here. We know with transitions that it's important to have several different components. We want to first give a countdown and let them know how many minutes are left until we're going to make a change. We want to give clear expectations of what we expect in their behavior. We want to give them visual and audio reminders without nagging, okay, but just periodic reminders. And then we want to give them praise when they're doing a good job. So let's walk through some of those examples with Brooke, and I'm going to give a couple of examples and ask you guys to say which one of these components that might be. So as Brooke is playing with her blocks, I'm going to say, Brooke, in 4 minutes, we're going to clean up our blocks and get ready to go to lunch. What's that an example of? And online folks, feel free to enter in the chat as well. It's a countdown. Yep. Anything else that it might be?
Clear expectations.
Right. Countdowns and expectations. Right. So
an audio reminder.
An audio reminder. That's right. So one thing I might say to Brooke now is I've got this safe zone tray. This helps her keep her material safe. And now I might, when it's 2 minutes to go, I might say, Brooke, it's 2 more minutes till we go to lunch. You've got this safe zone tray where you can keep your blocks when we're gone to lunch and no one will mess with your toys. What's that an example of? Pardon?
Clear expectations.
Uh-huh, clear expectations. Yeah. We've also using a real object to help her make a transition. Okay. And that
I assume this isn't happening for all the other kids. You aren't doing this for every kid in the group.
Just the one who needs it, actually. Right.
If they all need it?
Yeah.
20 cookie sheets. Yeah.
Yep. Whatever it takes, right? So now, as she's still playing and she's using her tray, I might say, Brooke, I really like the way you've got all your blocks on your tray and you look like you're ready to go to lunch. Great job listening to my directions. What's that an example of?
Praise.
And we want to heap on the praise. We'll talk more about that later. But she's following directions, doing something that she might not necessarily quite have wanted to do, but she's following our directions and getting ready to make a shift. So all of these things are important components that we want to teach our children. Another important part of having a supportive environment is to use real-time examples. Children don't necessarily understand, oh, we'll do that in a while, or we'll do that in a few minutes. They may not understand what that means. A lot of times we don't know what that means. We want as much as possible to use real concrete examples when time is of the essence. We encourage you to buy a huge clock like this so that children can see what the time concept actually looks like, and we can use it throughout our day to let them know what's coming. So for instance, if it's a sunny day, what I might say to the children is, when the big hand gets to the three, that's when we get to go outside. So we can use this throughout the day, teaching them when the big hand is wherever, what's coming up next. It's a great visual reminder.
And it's a good way to kind of reflect back to the child to help get that thinking back in. Is they might say, is it time to go outside? And you could say, I don't know, is it? And then you're allowing them to start, well, I guess I could have looked myself, you know?
Yeah. Another great example is, and I'm sure you all use these in your homes and classrooms, is to have timers. So that when children are in a certain center playing, when they start playing, we're like, okay, you have 5 minutes in the computer center. You start the timer, and they know, they learn quickly that when that timer goes off, they have to leave and someone else is coming in. And the kids they're waiting know that when the timer goes off. So it's a more objective gatekeeper than us going, oh, it's not quite time. They don't know what not quite time means. So those are just some ways that we can.
Your mouse is hovering over there.
Oh, okay. So in other words, if I need to really figure out if my classroom is supportive, providing a supportive environment, really a way to check it is to get on my knees and walk around and see what they see. It's sometimes scary what I see when I'm down on my knees and looking around, but that's where they are. So if I really want to know how it's supporting them, that's what I do to check. So let's look at some pictures and see what you all think. What is this environment telling our children? Online people, feel free to chime in.
Chaotic.
How so?
Just a lot of stuff going on in one area.
Yeah, there's a lot of stimulation there and a lot of visual stimulation.
Participant online said run.
Yes, that's exactly what I think. This is like, you know, go for it. Run around, be wild, right? There is no dividers here. It's a wide open space. It's telling them to run.
Dan online says no organization.
Yeah.
Virginia says overstimulating.
Yeah, you're getting the idea. Great.
Virginia also says, don't know where to start first.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not very good.
It's an open book, which is not helpful to children. It doesn't help them organize and plan their day. Great. What is this kind of a environment telling children?
Shows them they have a place.
They have a place to sit. Mm-hmm. What else? How do they know where to go?
I guess their pictures.
Their own pictures. Yep. Children love to see. I mean, we all love to see pictures of ourselves. And you can fix a picture of them, and this can be used throughout the day. It can be their circle time picture. It can be their snack chair picture. A variety of things. They love to see pictures of themselves.
Online participant says, I belong here.
Yes, that is the message we want them to get. Very good.
Virginia says, helps them to know which spot is theirs.
That's right. Yep, everyone belongs and everyone has a spot. That's important for our children to feel that. What is this picture telling them?
when they put them on, when you put them on the floor, it's directions to get somewhere.
Right. So these are on the, these are on the floor. And what do you think these picture, the little.
Stand on number seven or go stand on number two.
Right.
That's a standing in line.
It tells them which place is theirs.
Jenny says how to line up, which direction to face.
Yeah.
Yes.
How far apart you should be from your friend in front of you.
Yes.
Jeffrey says, this is the way.
Yes. Guys are sharp. Great. And while this seems really simple to us, you know, four footprints on the floor, this is the kinds of stuff that our kids are learning and that they love. They love to have a card that's theirs. You know, they love to have a different color, a different number. They're learning their numbers. They're learning sequences. There's lots of things that they're learning here that we think are fairly simple, but it really makes their life simpler. They might have colored those pictures. I bet Brooke colored them. We'll talk about that in just a minute. Because she happens to love coloring. You'll find that out. So what does this picture tell them?
Two more people can play.
It's two more. Their size.
Uh-huh. It's their size. Two more can play.
But when there's no more room, there's no more room.
Right. When we get to four kids, when every square has a body, it's closed.
Online participant says squares indicate where to stand.
Yes. Yes. Good job. And with little children, especially really youngsters around a sensory table, that can get really crowded really fast, especially if you roll out something new and exciting, and you can have pandemonium with a lot of kids in a small space. So this helps it stay more calm.
An online participant says teacher doesn't have to make those decisions, a child can visually see.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That was from Rachel.
Good job. What does this picture tell? What's the message here?
Those are the only people that are allowed in block center. No one else can go over that.
Well, it's saying that there's three there. How many more people could fit? One more could fit. It's their real pictures again, so we know who's in there. What area is it?
Block
area. So we know in the block area there's four. In another area there might be more or less. Computer area might have two.
An online participant says, who is allowed to be in the block center and one more could fit?
Yes, exactly. Good job. You guys have this.
Now, are you saying the children are actually putting their pictures
yes.
in here?
Well, it depends on your classroom. It depends on your children's ability. In some classrooms of older children, older preschoolers, they could do that themselves. In some classrooms, they'll need help just telling me where they want to go, and I'm going to help them put their picture there. So it really depends on the children's understanding level.
I was thinking it would be hard for the child maybe to remember to take their picture off and go to the next place.
Some children will need more help than others yeah. using that system. Yep, good point. All right. So just to review some of the things that we've talked about with ensuring supportive environments, we want to use those visual daily schedules. We want to limit surprises, recognize that transition is a challenging skill, use real-time prompts, and have visual cues and auditory cues as much as possible. So now we're going to practice. You all are going to practice some.
Right. So we're going to connect some dots. Does that sound exciting? All right, everybody here. Sorry, online, has these really cute, fun dots. So I want everybody to grab the red one. And I want you to work with your partner or in tables of three, or if you're joining us remotely, then you'll do it individually. And there's a place on your handout that has this picture, hot button. And I want you guys to think about a scenario, like Caroline and I acted out, where you see common hot button behaviors. And I want you to write it on your red hot button. So for us, it was throwing a fit when it's time for lunch. So this is the hot button. And what we're going to do is, as we walk through each of the four dots, we're actually going to connect the four dots to the hot button behavior or scenario that you choose. So pick something that you are really interested in correcting that's happening in your room or in your house or with a family that you're working with. And let's think through this a little bit. So take a moment and come up with your hot button. The second assignment is to think about what could you do in the environment
that might prevent or reduce that challenging behavior from happening. So somebody give me an example of what I did with Caroline in her environment to prevent the tantrum when I said, time for lunch.
Countdown.
I did a countdown. One more. What was it? The countdown was one.
Give her a choice.
I gave her a choice.
Gave her a choice. Repeated time prompts. Other
reminder.
Comment.
Okay. So what I did in her environment to ensure a supportive environment is I provided her a countdown, I gave some choices, and I did time prompts. So I want you to come up with your hot button behavior and also your blue dot. We're going to add everybody's blue dots to the front, and Walt is actually going to collect them from our online participants. If you don't have a scenario, we've provided three scenarios in your handout. Feel free to just pick one of those and work off of that if you don't have a challenging behavior right there on the tip of your tongue. We'll give you guys about 2 minutes.
Oh, if you guys don't mind to use the markers so we can see them up there. You got like one more minute.
It's the hot button. It's the hot button red.
Yeah.
Hot button.
So hot
frustration. Yeah.
Come on, you know you got it. All right, about one more minute. Tell him one more minute.
I do need a visual cue.
We have two. We have one. We need to make
one
visual or auditory cue.
A visual auditory cue. You're right.
Love it.
Here's your 1 minute visual cue.
So now we need to come up with a blue, like what we.
A blue, yes. So a few blues we already have are countdowns and clear expectations. Give choices, time prompts, countdown, clear expectations.
Okay. So what's something you could do in your environment?
Okay. All right, we're gonna come back together. Thank you. All right, we got some good ones here. And thanks for participating online. So I'm just going to read through a few of them. Meltdown at drop-off, throwing a tantrum when they can't get preferred seat in the cafeteria. Coming in from the playground, they're not lining up. Again, that was throwing the fit. If children are not following directions to transition from the gym for indoor gross motor, and I love this, the flop and drop, when they don't want to transition. So some ways, of course, I don't know exactly which ones coordinate with which ones, but some ways we can ensure a supportive environment are to count down and praise even for small victories. Count down, give choices, time prompts. Count down with clear expectations. Have songs for let's going inside, for going inside. So that's probably the lining up one. Walking around the playground to get some of that out. So that's maybe the transition that you go from all of that play with each other. We take a lap around the playground and then we go inside. It's really good. Give the expected song. That song is that transition trigger. Oh, that means we're getting ready to go in. Clear expectation choices. Remind child that they're currently seating lunchtime went fine. Praise trying different spots. Encourage new choices. Okay. And then count down clear expectations. You guys did awesome. All right. We're ready for our second dot.
Okay. So now if you want to refer to your poster, we're looking at the second row. We're going to talk now about how to encourage positive behaviors. And you have in your handouts a great summary sheet. You can look at it anytime. Looks like this. It's called Encouraging Positive Behaviors at the top, and it's just a great summary of what we're going to talk about today. So there are three main principles in terms of encouraging positive behaviors that we want to talk about today. The first one is that cooperation follows connection. We know in our work with children and we know in our work with adults, if we aren't connected to a child, they don't really care what we have to say. And if we don't have any kind of connection, or if we have a negative connection, they're going to go the other way from us. So it's really important that we establish a connection first so that children will want to engage with us and will want to cooperate in school or at home. Secondly, it's important that we fill their emotional buckets with positive reinforcement and specific positive reinforcement. So we're going to talk lots today about how to fill their buckets with some of the positive things that we can do, things we can notice, things we can do that fill their buckets. And third, we want to make deposits. We want to make deposits throughout the day, all our time with them. Notice things that are going well, notice them, pay attention to them, and make those deposits through the day. So these are the three principles we're going to talk about in this section about how to encourage positive behaviors with our children. We also want to remember that we want to model this for our families so that the things that we're doing at school that are positive and that are working, I want to share it with my families at the end of the day and during conference time so that they can also have this positive approach. We know that our bucket fills when we feel connected. We all know that, and our children know that too. Also, our bucket begins to drain when we feel disconnected. So when we feel fearful or tired or angry, our bucket starts to drain. We start to lose it. That's when our children start to lose it and they fall apart.
And they need our help to intervene before they get to that point where everything is run out of their bucket and they have nothing left. So as a child, we know that children are seeking connection to us first as an adult. Children that are first born seek it with their primary caregiver or their secondary caregivers. So that first primary connection is key. We know that in terms of attachment theory, how important it is that children have a solid connection with some significant positive adult. Then children can learn to connect to others, their peers, other adults in their environments, and importantly to themselves. That connection, however, starts with that significant adult in the beginning. So we have a nice demonstration here with our student and our teacher. And Walt is going to demonstrate for us this is one of the great strategies that I like in this section. We're going to talk about the 5-to-1 rule. Does anybody know this rule or use it?
Five phrases to one criticism.
Exactly. And so we're going to talk about some of the different ways we can use those five phrases. That's good. Because we know that before we ask anything challenging of a student, we better have given them lots of positive reinforcement or there's nothing there for them to draw on to do that challenging behavior. So we have Walt here playing with blocks, and we have his imaginary bucket here. And as we practice some of these strategies, Brooke is going to put deposits into his bucket. Okay? So one of the things that we can do is simply make eye contact. Some students like eye contact, some students don't. But for those that respond well, they really like it when we look at them and validate who they are and that we notice them. We can also just get close and touch children if they're okay with that. Some children are more accepting of touch than others. But physically being close to them lets them know that they matter to us and that we're attending to them. It's also important that we really be present with the kids. So as they're playing, Brooke is paying close attention to him. She's not looking at her phone. She's not scanning around the room and looking everywhere else but at him. She's right here present with him and enjoying him. She's on his level. She's looking at him eye to eye. She's right there for him. And he knows if she's really attending or not attending. Another example is that we can show interest in our ideas. If he starts taking it in another direction, she notices, she reinforces that. She's like, how cool it is what you're doing. We can show interest in what they're doing in their play. Another thing that we can do to fill their bucket is we can pay attention to them. In whatever it is they're doing, wherever it is they are, we pay attention to what they're doing, show them that we're really attending to what they're doing and what they like. When someone tries to interrupt her, she says, please wait, I'm here with Walt. Another thing we can do to fill their bucket, he liked that one, is we can laugh at their jokes. So if they're doing something silly or goofy or funny, we laugh with them and let them know that even if it's kind of a silly little joke, we think they're funny. They love that when we laugh at their jokes. We can also, yeah, it's pretty funny. Okay. We can also let them take the lead and play. So if Walt decides he's going to start adding some different components to his play and does something different, we can go, yeah, that's cool. Take it away. Go with it. As long as it's safe and it's not hurting anyone, by all means, let them take the lead. Another great tool we can use is to compliment them secretly. In other words, she's going to say something nice about him to me, another person in the classroom, not directing it at him directly, but she's saying it nicely about him where he can hear it. And then he knows she's complimenting him out loud. That really makes him feel good because she's saying what a great engineer he is. And that really makes him feel good to hear him complimented to me while she's watching. There's another deposit in his bucket. Another thing that we can do is build their confidence. If we see that they're really struggling with a task, we can encourage them to hang in there, to persist, to try another way, and build their confidence to do risky behaviors. She helps him figure out new ways, building his confidence. We can also just really enjoy their company. Children know if we like their company or not. And there's some children who we are more at ease with than others. They know that. And so it's important when she's working with him that he knows she really likes him. She really wants to be there with him. So when kids tried to interrupt, she's like, no, I'm busy here. I'm with Walt. They know that he knows that she really likes his company. We can be really enthusiastic about their effort. If a child is really struggling and the product isn't quite what they wanted, and we have kids who get really frustrated with that, we can say, you know, it may not look the way you want, and I love your effort. You're really trying here, and praise their effort rather than their product. And lastly, it's important that we give away control when we can. So again, if he wants to take his play in another direction, he wants to bring in another object, or he wants to move it to a different part of the room, as long as it's safe and he's not hurting himself or anyone, let them take the control in directing their own play and their activities. So as you can see, they've had a great interaction time here, and she's put lots of deposits in his bucket. And it may be that he loves this block time, but he doesn't quite so much love leaving it and going to lunch. So Brooke has done this intentionally to get him ready for a time that's going to be more challenging. So when we say, okay, you know, Walt, it's time for us to put, and we've given him all the transition cues. When we say it's time now to put the blocks away and go to lunch, even if he's kind of frustrated and loses some of those deposits from his bank because he was pretty mad, still, he's got some supply left in his bank. He's got some reserve to be able to cooperate with us even when he wasn't really crazy about it. So again, as you said, we need to remember for every challenging direction we give, we need to have given at least 5 positive points ahead of time. And that takes some practice. We're going to talk about some of the things we can do to practice that. Thank you both. Great demonstrations. So another way we can think about this 5-to-1 rule is for ourselves. So, for instance, you know, if my boss has to come to me with a correction, I would much rather that she come to me and tell me 5 really great things I did before she says, yeah, and we had a complaint too. Same thing applies to us. And if we're working on a team, I'm going to build up my team as much as possible with specific positive praise before I say, and here's something we need to work on that's a challenge. Works the same for us. So here's another tool that I really like. Anybody use a one-on-one schedule with their child, with their kids, or their classrooms? Okay, it's a cool tool, I think. What we do with this tool is I pay attention to each of my students, and I figure out for each one of them something that they love to do. So as I mentioned earlier, I know that Brooke loves to color, and she's really good at coloring. So I put together a one-on-one schedule. I literally write it down for all of my kids, and I actually post it on the wall so that the families know I'm spending unique time with their child every week. I'm doing at least a couple of minutes with each child somewhere throughout the week. So my special time with Brooke is Monday morning. She comes in, I've got those coloring books ready. There's not many kids there yet, and she loves it. It's our one-on-one time together. For instance, with Jack, he's there with us for long days. His parents don't pick him up until late on Friday afternoon, so we're in the gym together. Oftentimes, it's just a few of us left in the gym. So that's the time that Jack and I play trains. And again, that is our special time, and he knows it, and I know it. And it really builds that connection and that positive reinforcement for our kids. They realize that we pay attention to what they love, and we spend individual time with them doing those positive things. Can't go wrong with that kind of approach. Usually we send notes home to parents, and what do we say in those notes? Things aren't going so well a lot of times with the notes we send home. And our suggestion is instead, let's send bucket filler notes home. So if Brooks had a really good day, or if Walt's had a really good day, and if he learned to put his blocks up and go to lunch without an issue, I'm going to send a note home and say, Walt did great today going from blocks to lunch. I'm going to send a note home saying, Brooke did great today coloring this morning. She colored 5 pages. It really, parents love to get these notes. We love to hear where our children are doing well. Another example is we can do this at a classroom level, and Brooke is going to demonstrate for us. I want to, in addition to reinforcing my children individually, I want to reinforce my whole classroom when things are going well throughout the day. Because the more I reinforce the classroom is running well, the more it's going to run well. So one of the things that we can do is we can have an apron with a pocket or two, and we've got 20 pennies in the bag. And what I do is each time I hear myself praising the whole class, I take a penny out of the Ziploc and I put it in my pocket. And the idea is by the end of the day, I've put all those pennies into the other pocket so that it reminds me to reinforce my whole classroom 20 times at least during the day. If you're lucky enough to have people who can come in and observe and take notes for you and do that for you, great. If not, this allows me to do it on my own. And it just reminds me to do that reinforcement with my whole class throughout the day. And we know what amazing difference this makes. We know how that changes the whole tone of the classroom. Your turn to practice.
All right. Okay. So now we're going to connect the next dot of connection. We want to remember the point of the connect the dots and referencing back to what we learned about the brain, right? So what did we do in ensuring a supportive environment? What are we responding to?
An anticipated need.
Yes, of safety, right? So what are we responding to with dot two? Right, the emotional state. So let's assume that we've done an awesome job at making them feel safe. Our transitions are smooth, they know what's expected of them, and we're really not having any of the alarms go off for safety. But the next thing we have to do is make sure that they're feeling good about themselves and that they feel connected to the class. So if you have a new student, you probably see a lot of challenging behaviors. And that's because two things are out of whack. Safety, everything's new, and two, they don't have a sense of belonging yet. So it's really, really important to recognize when you're seeing tons of challenging behaviors from new students, it's because they're seeking that connection first before you're going to get any kind of cooperation. So I want you to think back on your hot button and assume you've already ensured a supportive environment, because that's what we did with the blue dot. And now I want you to take your green dot out. And I want you to tell me how you're going to make five deposits into this bucket before that challenging behavior happens. So if there's a frustration or meltdown was one of them, tell me what five things you're going to do before that meltdown happens, because most likely you know when it's going to hit, right? Everybody's nodding in here. Okay, couple minutes.
We think you guys are doing a great job. So let's move to our third dot, which is emphasizing positive discipline. We're going to look at, in this section, at some great, yes. Okay.
So our question was, I mean, I know a lot of times, a lot of prompts, a lot of structure for them. How do you, or what is your experience of them transitioning from such a structural environment?
To less structure?
Yeah, you know, the split frames and the squares and, you know.
Good question.
For them to see that independent.
So what's your experience? Have you seen kids go from a supportive environment to less? Have you seen that happen?
I don't know, so I'm asking. I don't work with children.
Okay. Okay, the question is, if we set up a really great supportive environment in our center, have we seen what happens when kids move to environments that are less supportive? That's our question.
Yes.
I want to see what they have to say first. Anybody have experience with that?
I think as children mature, they want less structure. And so it's a lot of times a natural thing that they want that structure. I'm a mother of five, so just that they want that structure younger. And there is a reason that, you know, teenagers are not our best friends, because they're pulling away. So with that maturity, you know, it kind of comes natural, I guess.
So there's an answer that, if you can't hear online, that children oftentimes want more structure, need more structure when they're younger, but as they get older, they want less and they need less.
Yeah, as we teach them when they're younger, we teach them the practices that they should be doing automatically, like the example with the footprints. They should eventually learn how to just stay in line without those visual cues. So those visual cues are like little training wheels, and as soon as they don't need them, you can take them off.
Yes. Good answers. Yes.
Jenny online says, yes, my kids come undone behaviorally when they get home from preschool because home is not as structured as school is.
Yeah. And so what she's learning the hard way is that they're getting the structure they need at school. And when we come home, for most of us, it's less structured at home. And sometimes that's okay. And sometimes I even need more structure. I still need some structure at home more than I get. And I think your question points out a really good observation, is that really it's about watching our kids. And as they move from a structured environment to a less structured, some kids are going to do fine.
Some of my kids, when I transitioned them, I had to work with the teachers in the new setting, and they had to give them more supports for a while. And that's really what we call transition supports, going from one setting to the next where the expectations are different, and they always are. We have to work with the new staff who get them to work with what the child needs and what the environment offers. So it's a really good question you raise. Any other thoughts?
We have an online question. Could you give suggestions about filling the bucket of a child who seems to feel safe and has positive emotions, yet still does not want to transition from playground or transition to the bus?
Okay, so we've got a child who seems to be pretty well adjusted, but doesn't want to go from the playground or to the bus?
Still does not want to transition from playground or transition to the bus.
Pretty normal, right? So what do you suggest? What do you all suggest for that? Yeah.
I worked in their Kentucky Children's Foundation like before, and I did the craft for the kids. And like the first time, you may get it messy, but when you do it again and again, then the kids will get help that. So
by practice?
Yeah, by practice.
Practice, which may many times of going to the, leaving the playground even when they didn't want to, or going to the bus, practice helps. What else helps? Yeah.
We have an online participant using the acronym ACT, A-C-T, acknowledge the emotion, communicate the limit, target the alternative.
Yay. We're going to talk about a strategy very much like that. So I like that. Acknowledge.
Acknowledge the emotion is A, communicate the limit is C, and then T, target the alternative.
It's a great strategy. Yeah.
I just had a question. What if there's a reason? Like the boys being bullied on the bus.
Yeah. So what if there's a really good reason that they don't want to get on the bus? How can we address that one? What do you think?
I don't know.
Anybody? What do you do? I mean, because sometimes children have legitimate reasons why they don't want to leave the playground or they don't want to go on the bus. What can we do?
I was going to say, have a problem-solving conversation with them if they're here and they're in that place, but they can't be
stressed
about it.
Oh, good idea. Her response was, get them to hear and problem solve. And a lot of times, if we ask children in a non-threatening way, like, is there a reason you don't want to go on the bus today? A lot of times, if they have verbal skills, they'll tell us. Or we can ask the bus driver, is there something going on? Yeah.
That, I feel like that's more for once you get to school-age children. I think for this age group, that'd be a little bit more difficult.
Depends. Some can tell you, some can't. You're right. Some can't begin to verbalize that terrible things are happening on the bus. It's true.
Or if they're not wanting to get on the bus and they're starting to throw that tantrum, you can be like, how is your body feeling? Like, what do you feel inside? And it's like, well, do you think that your heart is beating really fast because you're nervous? It's like, if you ask them to think about how they feel physically, you can kind of connect that to the way they're thinking.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Helping them name how they're feeling. It's a great skill.
Yep. An online participant suggests reflective responding, such as, I see that you don't want to get on the bus, or you seem really upset about getting on the bus.
Yes.
Reflective responding.
And that's exactly what Brooke was doing earlier. She was naming Walt's feelings. I see that you're frustrated. That helps to just have someone go, hey, I see that you're upset here. That is a start in the dialogue of finding a solution. All right, well, let's look at some specific strategies. Those are great suggestions that you all have. And if you'll read the font and color with me, let's look at why it's so hard to teach behaviors. If a child doesn't know how to read, we teach. If they don't know how to swim, we teach. If they don't know how to multiply, we
teach.
If they don't know how to drive, we
teach.
If they don't know how to behave, what do? Yeah, a lot of times we punish instead of teaching. Why is it so hard to teach behavior? Why do you all think?
We have to behave ourselves.
Yeah, it requires us to behave well. What else? Why is this a hard one?
It takes patience and consistency.
Yes. And those are hard to come by. It takes patience and consistency. Online agreed. It's also not a really clear-cut area of performance. Behavior can be pretty variable in different settings, with different people, with peers versus adults. It is not a clear-cut. Yes.
Rachel online, before you started that last statement, says, because there are so many different aspects to consider.
Yeah.
she had that in before she started. Yeah.
So this is why this is a challenging area for a lot of us and for our children, because this is a complex deal. Yes.
Well, the other thing, what we teach with our limited time with a child, they may go to their home environment or other environments, and for reading or swimming, the other environments don't teach them how not to swim. They don't actively teach them how not to read. There could be active behaviors in the child's life that encourage behavior that's inappropriate.
Yep, it's true. So they might be learning very different expectations and limits, very different limits in other settings than they're learning at school. Absolutely. And then they're like, okay, which one do I do? The amazing thing is kids know how to behave in different settings. They know that what they can get away with at school, they can't get away with at home, and vice versa. They figure that out, that different settings have different limits. Good points, you all. Well, let's look at some specific strategies. You have in your handout a sheet that looks like this that has 7 different strategies for handling, emphasizing positive discipline. And that the Great Example Act is one similar to one that we're going to look at in just a little bit, but I just want you to be able to see this and know this is chock full of resources, and this is just a small example of what more available is available online on Connect the Dots website. Yes?
Do you mean positive punishment, like you're giving a punishment versus like taking something away?
No, where are you seeing punishment?
I mean discipline, sorry.
Oh, by positive discipline, we mean using positive phrasing to correct children. I don't mean punishment in any sense of the word. It's a good question. So you'll see that we have some of the strategies that are listed here include setting clear expectations. We've talked about that already. Modeling appropriate behaviors. We've been doing that. Redirecting behaviors. We've done some of that. Using flippance is what we're going to talk about soon. Allowing children choices. We know that's always a healthy thing to do. Give them choices of what is a realistic choice, and don't give a choice if it's not a choice. Giving logical consequences, using when-then statements. When you do this, then this will happen. And actively ignoring inappropriate behaviors. If there's behaviors that I can ignore that don't hurt anyone, I'm going to ignore them. And oftentimes, they'll go away. Now, if I ignore a behavior and it escalates and then I have to step in, then I'll use one of these other strategies. But I always try ignoring first if it's not hurting anyone. So, we have lots of strategies here. We're going to concentrate on the flip it strategy, just as an example. This is the resource where it comes from. Flip it stands for, it's an abbreviation for identifying children's feeling, setting limits, asking questions, inquiries, and prompts. And it's very much like the ACT that our online person said, very much like that. So we're going to, as Walt is playing with his blocks, Brooke is going to help him work through this flip it scenario. So what's happening here is that he's playing with his box and he might be getting a little bit frustrated. So she's going to first help identify his feelings.
Because I don't want him to flip his lip. Oh, I can see you're feeling frustrated with those blocks.
So the next thing she's going to do is she's going to remind him what our limits are in school.
When we play with the blocks, we handle them with gentle hands.
And the next thing she's going to do is she's going to ask him some questions to help him figure out what's going on with his feelings.
If you're frustrated, the blocks won't hit or fit together. What else can we do to get our frustration out besides banging them?
So she's asking him questions, helping him problem solve, helping him close his lid and do some problem solving. And lastly, if he needs help, she's going to prompt him for what he might do differently.
So remember that book we read yesterday? Henry stomped his feet when he felt frustrated. We can do that. Or you could simply say, I need some help, please. Do either of those sound good to you? Sure, I'd love to help you.
So she's helped him problem solve through his identifying his feelings, setting those safe limits, asking some questions, and prompting him to problem solve what he needs to figure out. So flip it is a great technique that helps us change the whole tone of a child's behavior. We encourage you that if a lot of these are new strategies to you, pick one or two that really speak to you. Pick one or two and practice them a lot. Go to the website, check out the resources, look at the videos. There's great videos on all of these strategies that you can dig into deeper. We encourage you to work on one or two at a time. Once you get comfortable with those, then you can add another to your repertoire. Another example of using a strategy for emphasizing positive discipline is to use positive discipline language with my family. So as we talked about before, if I find that active ignoring is working, then I'm going to share that with the families at the end of the day. So for instance, I might say, as they come to pick up their child, I might say, I found today that when I actively ignored when Walt was whining for more dessert, that he just moved on and finished his lunch and went right on and did fine. So I'm sharing with them that active ignoring works so that they can also use it at home. Sometimes we don't think to do that. Sometimes we think we have to respond to everything that they do and say, and a lot of times we can simply ignore it and it will go away. That's our first line of defense. Another strategy we can use is helping children connect what they're feeling to what they're saying and what they're doing. So if Brooke is playing and she starts getting frustrated and upset, I can look at her face and say, your face is telling me that you're, she's feeling pretty good.
Oh, I'm sorry.
If she's frustrated, I can say, your face is telling me that you're frustrated, which is helping her learn that emotional vocabulary that she might not have. Kids don't automatically know when they're feeling mad, sad, glad, or any of those. So we're teaching her the words for how she's feeling. Was there a comment online? Okay. So another couple of strategies that we can use, we can, as Dave said, we can model calming strategies. And that is really our goal in school, is to model how to be calm with our kids. One of them that we can use is we can do either cranky lotion or cranky soap. So as the teacher, I'm going to get cranky sometimes, right? And so when I'm feeling that my blood pressure is rising, I might just say, here's our model teacher, I'm going to step aside for a minute and I'm just going to wash my cranky away. And I'm going to go wash my hands. Those are my calming glasses. And I'm going to step aside and take a little break until I feel better. Same way with cranky lotion. If I'm getting really agitated, I'm going to say to Walt, I'm going to step over here and just massage my hands for a minute. I'm going to get some lotion and I'm going to do a hand massage just for a minute to pull myself back together so I don't lose it and I can be more appropriate with him. So cranky lotion, cranky soap is a great strategy. Another one is a strategy we call STAR, which stands for smile, take a deep breath, and relax. I want you guys to practice this with me. Let's all smile, take a deep breath, and relax. I mean, even doing that makes you feel calmer, right? So if I see myself losing it or feel myself losing it, I'm going to post this on the wall, by the way, so that I can look at it whenever I need it, remind myself to smile, take a deep breath, and relax before I help someone who's not having an emergency.
And these tools make it more fun, because sometimes it can sound a little like this if you're telling somebody to calm down. So it's a way to kind of say, do it in a more of a kid-friendly way that seems kind of silly. And really what you're doing without them realizing it is you're also redirecting their attention. So now they're focused on washing their hands. They've had about a 25-second relaxation moment, and they come back like this. They don't realize they just walked away and took deep breaths. So it's a way to start programming that and creating that roadmap before the language is there, as you pointed out. Thanks.
So now it's your turn.
Oh, wow, I'm back up. Okay. All right, so now, as you can guess, we're going to do the third dot. So to go through a few of the ones, we concentrated on flip it, which is an awesome one. Feelings, limits, inquiries, prompts. Don't flip the lid, flip it. Set clear expectations, modeling appropriate behaviors, redirecting, kind of curbing that behavior to some focusing attention on something else. Logical consequences, when you put your shoes on, then you can go outside. Not even presenting the alternative to that. And then actively ignoring inappropriate behaviors. I'd like you to think about your home button. We have calmed the survival mode, right? We have helped them feel connected to us. We have a full bucket going in to the situation, right? But still, we have to teach appropriate behaviors. We aren't born knowing how to handle the feeling of frustration or disappointment when playground time is over. So that's when the third dot comes in. How are you going to teach in a positive way how to handle that feeling of disappointed playground time is over? Take a moment with your group and fill out your third dot How are you going to emphasize positive discipline? Which of the 7 techniques or one of the tools that Caroline presented are you going to use? Go. So good job there. Do we have any questions about the third dot?
Questions? We were just talking about how to actively ignore. And it's not as easy as it sounds, actively ignoring. Do you have some special guidance or?
So actively ignore, you're still fully present in the moment. You're ignoring the behavior, not the child. So that's the best kind of way I can think of. So we don't want to just ignore the child in the moment, but we're going to actively ignore whatever behavior it is that we don't like. So if you're playing with the balls nicely, Caroline, but you're whining about how you didn't get dessert at lunch. So, oh, cool, you're playing with those balls. I'm just going to ignore the fact that she's whining about no dessert at lunch. Oh, cool, how many do you have? 1, 2, 3, and she might be saying things like, but so-and-so got a cookie, and I didn't get a cookie. 5, 6, 7, 8. That's how you would actively ignore. So you're showing the child, I'm not ignoring you. You're still very important to me, but that behavior, I don't have time for that. And that behavior is a very much, that's a, you know, closed-lid behavior. They're not in a survival mode. She's not, you know, feeling frantic about connection. She's trying to see if maybe you're going to get back in the cupboard and get another cookie out if she keeps it up. And so I'm just going to actively ignore that. And then as soon as she engages in conversation that's different from whining, I'm going to praise that. So she might say, hey, can you hear me that? Oh, you want me to hand this? Sure, I love how you used your manners. And you're going to immediately jump to the next thing. So you just act like it didn't happen.
And we also know that if we do give in and give her the cookie, we've lost the battle.
10 more times you got to do it.
You just made a whole new roadmap, and they're going to travel it a few times to see if it's going to work like it did the last time.
Yeah. Good question.
Thank you.
So we're on to our 4th and my favorite dot. We're talking about children's unique strengths. And for this section of our training, many of you did the VIA character survey beforehand. If you didn't, you have one in your packet, and we're going to do that now. What we'd like you to do is just take a minute at your tables and circle your top 5, your top 5 character strengths, and share about it with your table mates. And we're going to use this, our strengths, to look at how we can also recognize our children's unique strengths. So we'll give you just a minute to do that. Circle your top 5, share about it at your table if you wish.
Online people can text it to us now.
Yes, and online people, please text us your top character strength. Chat in the chat box. Give us your top strength. All right, let's talk about what you have. Anyone want to share what their top strength is? We've got some of the online folks. Walt can tell us. Anybody want to share what their strengths are?
Do you want all 5?
Yes. Sure.
Honesty, kindness, fairness, hope, and humor.
Thank you. Who else? Yes.
Judgment, kindness, teamwork, humility, and spirituality.
Great. Thank you. Yes.
Fairness, honesty, social intelligence, and humor.
Great. Walt, what have you got from online?
Patience was one of their top strengths. Kindness was a top strength. Gratitude was a top strength. A couple online participants. Appreciation, beauty, and excellence.
Great. Anyone else want to share? Okay. Thanks for those answers. It's amazing how when we think that's a different way than we oftentimes think about ourselves. And I want to encourage us to do this same kind of thoughtful examination of our kids. We're going to watch a video now that helps us understand embracing children's unique strengths. This is from the perspective of children and families, but I encourage us that this applies to us in schools and caregiving just as well.
As early as age 5, children develop strong beliefs about themselves, other people, and the world. Wouldn't it be great if they recognized their own strengths around that time? Of the 24 character strengths, about 10 begin to emerge in early childhood, and each child shows them in their own unique way. Imagine your child is playing at the park. He may climb to the highest slide or be more cautious. He may be comfortable as part of a big group, or maybe he quietly watches. Maybe he's a little scientist, eagerly observing the ant colony. Each child brings his or her own unique strengths into every situation. Core character strengths are the early building blocks of every child's personality. These strengths are what your child will rely on throughout his or her life when faced with challenges and opportunities. Many times, though, parents are unaware of these strengths when they emerge in children. You might catch a glimpse of a small act of kindness, such as a pat on the back, a smile, or a hug, but this can be quick. On the other hand, a child's overuse of a strength such as humor may seem irritating. When we are aware of this, we can more easily spot and understand our children's emerging character strengths. As parents, how should we think about our role in our child's character strengths development? It's helpful to think about character strengths as flowers in a garden. The best nutrients for these seedlings of strengths are a parent's love and attention. Seeing your child's strengths, talking about them, and celebrating them will help them grow and last a lifetime.
Character strengths are a pretty amazing discovery in the field of psychology that can be very useful to parents. I think it can help parents understand their children in terms of how to help them unfold and become best versions of who they are and to fulfill their potential.
It can come about in many different ways. We observe our kids and we talk to our kids. And I think it's through both, through our observations and through what the dialogue is that we have with our kids, that we can begin to see their character strengths. But it's not just in seeing and observing the strengths, it's in how you relate it back to the child and how you have a dialogue with them, how you have a discussion with them.
All right, I think that's a great illustration of what we're emphasizing here. Dave, how do I get it off?
Art, it's very, very nice.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. So as we think about looking at our children with this new perspective of like, what is their unique strength? And what are some of the strengths that we realize that they have that maybe isn't being fully recognized yet? This is one of the great tools that's available on the website. I like printing this out and posting it on the wall so that I can reframe how I view my children. So for instance, I might have a little guy who is kind of bossy, or I might formerly have thought of him as bossy, and I'm going to reframe that rather I think he's a really good director and he's a natural born leader. Or I might have a child who's real whiny, and instead I'm going to think, well, no, she's connected. You know, she's right there at my hip. She's connected to me. Or I might have a child who's just really goofy and funny. I'm going to reframe how I see that child as someone who's joyful and entertaining and fun to be around. So I encourage us to study our children carefully for some of their strengths and reframe how we're thinking about some of these positive strengths and really notice what those unique strengths are that they bring to the equation. So again, this is a great tool that you can use. And as you know, one of the tools that I love is the one-on-one list. So I've added to my one-on-one list with the unique strengths that I've noticed with each of my students. And this also helps my families realize some of the unique strengths that their children have. So with Brooke, not only do we color on Monday mornings, but I noticed that she really brings a lot of enthusiasm to coloring. And so zest is one of her great qualities. And so I say to her folks, you know, I love the way she's so enthusiastic about coloring with me on Monday mornings. And they realize also that they can appreciate that she's got that enthusiasm. Or with Jack, we play trains on Friday afternoons. He's really curious and he likes to tinker with those trains and blocks and find other ways to work with them. And I tell his folks, you know, he's really curious about the ways that he plays, and that helps them see their children in a whole new positive light. And finally, one thing that we can use as one of the tools based on looking at a positive slant on children, if I've got a child who's a real jokester and jokes a lot, what I might say in the parent-teacher conference is, you know, Ella is great. She tells a lot of great stories. She can always come up with a joke. And I'm trying to also help her learn when to listen and follow directions more. One of the tools that we can use in our parent-teacher conferences is we can have them do this kind of a idea where if parents are there for an activity,
they have this simple paper plate, and one of the things that they do is they tell me all the wonderful things about their child, like that she's spiritual and determined, or he, and strong and athletic. And then on the other flip side, we realize some of the things that we need to work on. So, you know, she's affectionate, or he's affectionate, he needs lots of reassurance. So it kind of gives them a view of both sides, the flip side of the strengths, and then some of the things that we need to work on to balance those strengths, in other words. And it leaves them with this great image, this great tangible product about their child. All right, questions on that? Anybody experience, any of your experiences in pointing out character strengths in your students or children? Can you think of something where you've pointed out to a family a strength that they weren't really thinking about? Not someone? Okay. All right. Now it's your turn to work on this last dot.
All right. So we're going to do this one a little different. To recap a little bit, the first thing we did was, somebody tell me, we... Safety, ensured the supportive environment. Hold up your hand, show me what that, yeah, where is it? The bottom, okay. What might a kid in safety zone look like? Scared. Pure reaction mode, right? So if you have a kid in the bathtub and you go to put water on the hair and they totally freak out, they start screaming, that's a kid who has flipped their lid. It is no longer safe in this bathtub. Something just happened. So when you're like, he lost his mind, he actually did lose his mind a little bit. So we did ensure a supportive environment. We're setting up the environment for success. Then we go on to the second step, which is?
Encourage.
Positive behaviors. And it's the emotions one, right? So we're going to tap into, we're going to get those emotions involved by ensuring a supportive or encouraging positive behaviors. Then what do we have on? Our thinking cap.
Or directives.
No, we've got our thinking cap on. And now we can do strategies like actively ignoring choices, if, when, having those conversations about, I can tell that you're really frustrated. What are some of the things we can do? Only then can we do that. How do we feed into this cycle and prevent flipping our lid every single time? It's with this fourth step. That's the embracing unique strengths. By showing the child that you make really great decisions, or you're such a curious kid, I can tell you're so curious to climb all the way up there. But actually the rule here is we can only go to the second level. So you're embracing those unique strengths and finding other ways for them to be curious. But you're seeing it as a strength rather than a kid who's misbehaving. Maybe it's an overuse of a strength, but we don't want to squash it. So humor is a really great tool. It gets us through some really stressful, nerve-wracking times. So if you have a kid who's overusing humor, let's just help them use that strength in a better way, right? So what I want us to do is take these dots. I'm going to give our online people flop and drop. So if you're online, your hot button behavior is flop and drop when they don't want to transition. I want you guys to turn your hot buttons over. And I want you to write how this could actually be reframed into a personality positive, okay? And then also maybe another emerging strength that that could be indicative of. So throwing a fit when it's time for lunch. Let's do this one as a group. What could be the positive emerging strength from Caroline who throws a fit every day when she wants to go to lunch?
Leadership skills.
She has leadership skills. I like that. What else might Caroline have?
Cautious.
She's cautious. Yes, I like that too.
She has zest.
And she has zest. Okay, so online, you're in charge of flop and drop. And for those of you in the room, I'm going to hand these out to you. We'll have about 1 or 2 minutes to do this one. All right, so just to tell you a little bit, flop and drop. Turned into, is that what it's called, flopping up?
Uh-huh.
Determined, strong beliefs. We got some ignoring requests with the hot button behavior. Perceptive,
creative, curious, humorous, self-regulation. That is some self-regulation. Persistent, physically fit, was for drop and floss. For refusing to brush teeth, we got very independent. So that could be some independence emerging there. For meltdown at drop-off, we got values, close relationship with others, loyalty, cautious. Doesn't it feel better to be thinking about the child with those kind of personality traits? Not that we're allowing that meltdown every time, but instead we're just seeing maybe this is an overuse of something here. This child is extremely cautious, which is good. We want to be cautious as adults. How can we utilize that emerging strength in a way that speaks to that child, gets them back on our playing field, but at the same time, we're teaching them how to use it in an appropriate way? So that was Connect the Dots. Gonna review real quick. The first thing we're gonna do is ensure a supportive environment. We're gonna encourage the positive behaviors. Then we start in with the emphasizing positive discipline. And we close this up by embracing their unique strengths and understanding what's unique and individual about each child. So we're not gonna flip our lids. We're gonna learn to connect the dots. KentuckyCCHC.org, we add stuff weekly. We're also going to start a listserv option. The Early Childhood Mental Health Specialists of Kentucky are the ones who generate a lot of this content. We have a new one in the room today. Little did she know, this is part of your job. So we have lots of awesome resources coming in all the time. Specialists are saying, hey, I saw this out there. Try this. We also collaborate with a lot of early Head Start and Head Start programs. So they're sending us fresh ideas that they see, and we post it all up there, give you guys access to all those goodies. Do you feel like that you can recognize the four big buckets of social emotional development? Yeah, good. Have you identified at least two new classroom tools you're gonna use? Somebody shout out a classroom tool you're gonna use or a tool with families you serve. You like the star? Okay. She's going to take the star back. Anybody online? A tool you're going to use on Monday? Nothing. Come on, online. There's 80 of you out there.
Keep the bucket full was one strategy.
All right. I like it.
Flip it.
Was flip it. It. Okay.
Three participants said flip it.
All right.
Another participant said active ignore.
Active ignore.
Four said flip it, capital letters.
All right, thank you. Any more in here? New tools you're gonna take back?
Cranky lotion.
You like the cranky? I love cranky lotion. I do too. And you can actually make a big to-do about that. You could actually have somebody come in and it's like this magic cranky lotion. And I like this soap because it's different. It's called Can Do. It's designed for children so that they can operate the pumps and stuff. Plus, it kind of looks different, which makes it seem a little more magical. Because kids will call you out. They'll be like, I have that lotion at home.
Right.
That's not magical. No more what? Bad responses. We're not going to add chaos to a situation that already has plenty of its own. No more bewildered, agitated, or default to pleading. We're going to make these meaningful, teachable moments. Caroline, you're safe. We're just going to lunch. Your blocks are fine. I love that you're in my classroom. You've got two choices, though. Here's our two choices. You did an awesome job. This is not an emergency. Everybody's safe. You can take 10 seconds. Did I tell you that yet? No? Dr. Phelan says you have 10 seconds to react to a situation so that you can go from reacting to responding. Take your full 10 seconds. If it's not an emergency, take a step back and figure out what you're going to do. Just take a moment to say, okay, I've got choices, I've got resources, I tried this a few times, it didn't work. Maybe I attack it from this side. Give yourself a moment to star and then enter the situation as the calm, stable one who's gonna add some order to this moment. And that really helps you get down on the child's level and have a conversation. Seek help, reach out before you feel like you've tried everything. Challenging behaviors can really pull on our own insecurities and some own issues maybe we have. We've got to realize that sometimes when it hits this hot button, it is too much for us to handle on our own.
but it's different from another person's hot button. I can handle an insane amount of like noise and nothing, I don't even notice that it's loud. You might be somebody that really needs it calm. Realize that if that's your trigger, I can't handle whining. It makes me crazy. But for somebody else, whining might not be a big deal. Know what your hot buttons are, and if you can't minimize that challenging behavior, seek somebody else who maybe it doesn't really get on their nerves too much, and maybe they can help create that roadmap for you, at least at the beginning. We're all gonna say this as a group. Aha! Did you have an aha today? Yeah. Did light bulbs go off? Aha! My job is to recognize difficult behavior as a child telling me he or she needs social and emotional skills to solve problems. It's about coaching, not controlling. Yay! Hey, you guys, you all are so much fun. That was a good time. We've got like 6 or 7 minutes for questions. Caroline, get up here. And Caroline.
Questions? You guys have had great feedback.
Yeah.
Any other questions about challenging behaviors? Online as well.
Or any of the tools that you've seen, maybe how they actually look in the classroom?
Tell them about the pre and post.
So I think about 80 of you all total, a mixture between in here and online, completed the pre-survey. So I'll be emailing you. You'll get two evaluations. One will evaluate the training itself, and the second one will actually, we're trying to measure the content that you guys are getting. So did you learn something that you're going to actually change in your practice? So that post-test will probably come from my email, and then the training evaluation will come from Walt's email. If you complete the post-test, and you'd already completed the pre, then you're eligible for prizes. So we have these wonderful fill your bucket books. So if you complete the post-test, you'll be entered into a drawing, and then I will mail you your own copy of Fill a Bucket and have you filled a bucket today. And if you haven't read these, they're so good. So please complete those tests. Anybody have a question? Do we have any? Not yet. Okay.
Friday afternoon. Thank you all for your attention.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.